So, what you can see as an investor, there's a lot more things that you have to take into account. And in fact, although there are always market risks, an investor tends to get rewarded for them. What you don't get rewarded for are the operational risks. And that's where I'd like to spend a bit more time now. I'd like to introduce Max Ferry.
Hi, Mark.
Max is responsible for the operational due diligence process within Lavin Partners. And Max is going to spend a bit of time now explaining to us the process that goes on in looking at a hedge fund and spotting some of the operational risks that investors should be aware of but aren't necessarily always aware of. And this is a key part of the process that we have developed within ABN AMRO, and it's part of what we are doing on a day, well, on a day-to-day basis. But when we look at a hedge fund, when we want to bring it on board to service our clients, these are some of the things we look at. So, Max, perhaps you can just tell me a bit about the due diligence process.
Sure.
And how you go about it.
Sure, perfect. And as you rightly identified, Mark, you know, due diligence is about identifying the risks that lie in hedge funds and in investing into hedge funds. But, you know, we should be very clear, due diligence is really not just about spotting frauds, which have been obviously quite well spoken about in the press and so forth. It's also about understanding operations and whether or not the internal operations of the individuals that you're giving money to when you're investing into hedge funds are indeed up to a certain standard.
So when you say operations, you mean like the processes of a company?
The processes of a company, exactly, okay. Yes. Indeed, they're up to best, what we call best practice standards.
Okay.
And it isn't just about identifying those operations and ensuring that they are in place, it's also how effective are they. And indeed, our work and the way how we perform our work is that we trust, as in we follow, whatever a manager may say to us during an operational due diligence process, but then the real attention to detail is in the verification that we call verify. So we trust, but we verify.
Okay, so you basically check the things that they say they are saying.
That they're doing, exactly.
Okay.
And again, as I said, just to be clear, it's not just about frauds, it's about risk that can emanate from a strategy, whether it's over-excessive use of leverage, whether it's a lack of poor controls, lack of operations, et cetera, et cetera. And all of these are standards which are well set out in the industry. There are regulatory bodies like EMA, there are standard boards like the hedge fund standards boards, IOSCO, the managed funds associations. All of these bodies have set out a number of different best practice standards, which actually us at Lavin Partners have taken and have used as the standards that we would like to see in a hedge fund, when we assess a hedge fund.
Okay, so I'm obviously guessing that not all hedge funds apply all these standards. They're there, but and some people may say they do them,
exactly,
but don't always do them as well.
You're absolutely right. Okay. Not everybody does them. So really, the job of due diligence, apart from identifying a fraud, is also ensuring how diversified and how sophisticated the operations of a hedge fund may be, and whether or not they're really the top standards or they lie somewhere in the middle.
Okay. But when we're talking about due diligence, Max, surely when an investor invests into a fund, he carries out due diligence, doesn't he?
Yeah, they do. That's for sure. But I think what you're referring to mostly is investment due diligence.
Right.
So there are two things that must be identified, which are IDD, or investment due diligence, and ODD, operational due diligence.
Okay, so that's, to be clear then, investor due diligence is sort of understanding what the manager is investing in and sort of the style and the strategy.
That's right, yes.
Okay. Yeah. And operational due diligence is when you actually sort of look at the machinery of the company and how they do things on a day-to-day basis.
Exactly. Who's there to control the risk, essentially.
Okay.
Anyway, it can go into a lot of very sophisticated parts, like, you know, cash control policies and how are certain instruments valued. That's really the operational due diligence. But it's got to be clear, because also in the industry, a lot of players, sophisticated players who invest into hedge funds, have divided the investment due diligence and the operational due diligence sort of in two separate buckets. The reality is that to do proper investment due diligence, you must include you must also include an element of operational due diligence, and vice versa. So to do good operational due diligence, you must also include investment due diligence.
Okay.
And therefore, this is how we reach our IPOD report, which is known as the independent process of operational due diligence, by combining these two key due diligence sectors.
Okay, and that's obviously the report that you deliver to us as
ABN
AMRO.
Yes.
Okay. Now, perhaps you just tell me a little bit about the process and sort of some of the steps that you go through this, because obviously I think a lot of investors think that due diligence gets carried out, be it investor due diligence or operational due diligence, but they don't always quite understand what that actually means.
Yeah, you're right. And the process takes a number of different steps, as actually here we have identified as 7 steps from start to finish. And the first step would simply be just sourcing documentation. We all have to start from somewhere, and the documents is a great way to start.
Okay.
So we speak with the underlying managers, and we ask from them a number of key documents. Those are monthly or yearly fact sheets. These are the 1 or 2 pagers that many investors are accustomed to, that essentially set up the details of the investment strategy, the returns, and the parameters of the investment scope. We then have a presentation which goes into quite a lot of detail about the strategy itself, who the key individuals may be, and so forth. And then other documents, legal documents, such as the offer memorandum and the prospectus. These are the documents that are used by investors who subscribe into a fund and set are actually the laws, if you may, of your relationship with the hedge fund. And another very important document, one which is pretty much taken for granted in the industry now, is the due diligence questionnaire. It's essentially the first document that allows us to identify those controls, those processes. We're now deep into the ODD to understand who are the individuals, where and what key functions do they undertake, and also other elements of the operational due diligence assessment.
Okay, but maybe just to quickly ask you something, because I mean, I've seen also when you've looked at some funds for us in the past.
Sure.
You've actually seen discrepancies between the monthly fact sheets, for example, in terms of performance figures, whereby also there's a difference between what is written in the prospectus sometimes and what is written in the fact sheets.
Exactly.
And then also, but surely the due diligence questionnaire, if I receive that, isn't that enough?
No, you must use all 4 documents because each one of these key—that's why we call them the key documents. Each one of these key documents has a little piece of the story to be able to start the operational due diligence.
Okay.
So the monthly fact sheet would identify the performance, something which you're not really going to get in many other places. You will get it in the presentation as well, but it is a key analysis of the performance of the fund.
Okay. And I guess that also ties in then by checking the audited financial statements.
And checking also the audited financial statements. You're absolutely right. The audited financial statements are very important because essentially they are what you're buying. You're buying the performance are the audited financial statements. The valuation are the audited financial statements.
Okay, good. Okay, so once you've looked at all that information, what do you do next?
Well, the next step is really the desktop review. So it is decompiling that information. There's a number of other documents which we ask for, which includes legal agreements, it includes compliance manual, valuation policies. It's a lot of data. It's actually 25 documents or so for our standard due diligence. So lots of information, but we like information because information allows us to assess an operation even before going on site and therefore being really prepared in advance when we do meet to the management company and therefore have a lot of the questions that we want to ask during the on-site visit.
Okay, so that's when you've got your information and you go and see the manager, right?
No, not quite.
Okay.
There's one more step, which is essentially setting out and preparing the on-site visit. So we truly believe that for an on-site visit to be very successful, you must first of all set out everything in an agenda. You must ensure that you've understood the strategy. You must ensure that you perform an on-site visit. Some individuals in the hedge fund investment world tend or could perform conference calls instead of on-site visits.
Right. Yes.
But nothing really replaces an on-site visit.
No, exactly. Because I can imagine if you're a manager or someone who wants to invest and you're based in Europe, why do you go see a manager in New York, for example?
Yeah, it's very important, however, because until you're on site, until you're seeing them face to face, until you're seeing the operations, again, you're just more on the trusting side, as we said earlier, rather than the verifying.
Yeah.
It's important to verify, and to be able to verify, you must go on site.
Okay.
And the reason why you set on an agenda is to ensure that you meet all the key individuals. You want to ensure that you meet from senior staff members to junior staff members.
Right. So I mean, who do you typically go and see, for example? Because I know in some cases people say, "Hey, I've met the manager.
That's
good enough for me."
Yeah. No. That's just very small part of our operational due diligence. Actually, usually the manager is the first person that we see in our standard operational due diligence, which usually takes at least 1, if not sometimes 2 days, but just for the very first few hours. After that, we usually just kindly ask the manager to leave, and then we review the rest of the strategy and the rest of the fund and its operations with the other key members of the management company.
Okay.
So we'll spend time with the head of risk, we'll spend time with the chief compliance officer, with the chief operating officer, and even more importantly, with junior staff members such as analysts and so forth, to really get the real information from them.
Okay.
And whether or not.
So what you're actually saying is that, you know, by talking to the junior people, you probably get the real truth, because I guess they maybe aren't sophisticated enough to try and hide things or not disclose certain things, and probably they're not practiced at doing that.
Indeed, and the story often changes.
Okay, that's so right. You obviously probably need quite a lot of experience to try and coax that information out of them.
Yeah. It's also, as you said, it's a give and take, and you try to get the right information from different individuals and hear it very times. I go back to the verification. It's about verifying.
Okay, so that's where you basically have your on-site visit. Then.
That's when we then go on the on-site visit. You're absolutely
okay.
Right. And again, here we just make sure, as we said, that we trust and verify, and we go through all of the different elements of the internal operations of a hedge fund.
Okay. Now, when you go there, what are sometimes the reactions you get from certain managers? How does that work?
Well, we like to define them essentially as three key reactions and three types of visits. One is what we call the worried visit, which is usually a hedge fund manager that hasn't had many due diligences before. So they're not really prepared. They want to make sure that they are meeting the best practice standards. And sometimes they're just not educated as to what those best practice standards are. Let's be realistic. Although the standards are available, a lot of managers don't follow them for different reasons.
Why is that? I mean, I know we've looked at some managers, and I think quite often you see them, you know, they've been working in a big investment bank, and you see that on their CV, and you say, hey, great, you know, this manager's worked for a large bank, you know, he's got a good track record, everything should be fine.
Yeah, indeed.
I'm guessing what you're saying, that's not always the case.
That's not always the case. Unfortunately, a hedge fund is very much like it's a business.
Yeah.
So essentially, you're starting a brand new business. So it's not just about being a really good trader if you are, let's say, the star manager. That's one element of it. You're obviously in a place to be able to give your investors really good returns. Mm. But on the other hand, there's a lot of other moving parts. It's a business. It's about handling investors. It's about handling investors' money. It's about handling internal operations and so forth. So it's really about running a business.
Okay. So you have to be far more business person than just an investment manager.
An investment manager.
Okay.
That's absolutely
okay.
Right. So the worry stage really is when, again, some managers who haven't been exposed to many due diligences and aren't meeting, potentially may not be meeting those standards.
Okay. And that's also, I guess, very much the case when you invest into a first-time manager, which is, you know, sometimes one of the things you have to be at least aware of.
That's right.
Okay.
The good thing about the worried visit is that actually usually you get a lot of transparency in these kind of visits, because they want to impress, they want to be able to give you as much information as possible, they want to help you to perform due diligence. So we actually look at the what we call the worried due diligence quite relaxed, because we are going to get a lot of information from them.
Okay, good.
The responsive due diligence is the second step. It's basically where the manager has undergone a few due diligences, but it sometimes may not have fared too well, and therefore they just want to make sure that this time they're getting it right.
Okay.
Again, here, relatively relaxed, we do get the element of transparency that we require. Having said that, you know, since 2008, transparency has definitely increased, and we're getting a lot more information. And managers are realizing that actually the information belongs to the investors, because the investors are the ones who are invested and therefore funding the fund.
Okay, but I guess also what you're saying, you also get managers who don't give you anything either.
Absolutely.
They're
right.
Still sort of follow the old rules where everything is secret. No, I can't disclose everything to you.
That's absolutely right. And we still do get that even in this world. Those are the managers who you know, a lot of investors go to. They perform hundreds of due diligences, and therefore sometimes, depending on the investor profile, depending on who is also performing the due diligence and so forth, they may not be very responsive.
Okay, but yeah, quite often the feedback you get is, yeah, but I can't tell you this and that because it's, you know, part of my overall magic. You know, that's, I suppose, the whole allure of hedge funds. People say, well, I can't release that information because I'm giving out my trade secret. So no, I can't tell you anything.
Yeah, there are ways to get around that, and fair enough. I mean, although specifically some could be magic, the reality is that, you know, we don't need to see the trades that a manager has on their books today. we could easily look at trades that a manager had 6 months ago. All that we're there to do and all that our operational diligence should be about is the verification of those processes. So even if a manager shows us documents which are outdated, at the end of the day, we would still get the right information to ensure that the process is in place.
Okay. So what you're saying is you don't have to give up any secrets as such, but a sign of non-responsiveness is basically not a good sign.
It's definitely not a good sign, that.
Okay, yeah. Good. Okay, so who else do you actually speak to in this process? Because I guess what you've said to me now, you talk to the people within the fund management company.
Yes.
Who else do you speak to?
Well, here's where we then start the rest of the diligence, which is speaking to the third parties or the counterparties.
Okay.
So the administrators who have been appointed to manage the investors' redemptions and subscriptions, the net asset value of the fund. So we want to ensure that the administrator has the right controls and processes for valuing the fund accordingly. We also want to contact the administrator to get what we call the true track record of the fund, as they are officially the accountants, as we saw earlier, of a fund. They're the ones who have the month-by-month real NAV of the fund, and hence we want to get the NAV from them to compare it to the ones that we've received in the marketing material of the manager.
Okay.
We then speak to the prime brokers and custodians. These are the entities who essentially hold the assets of the fund. So we want to ensure that the assets under management that the manager is saying to us match the ones that the custodian or the prime broker may have in their custody. We want to ensure that there are right controls for transferring cash and so forth. And then the last people that we speak to are the auditors. We just want to ensure that essentially they are the auditors of that entity, that they have recently performed the audited financial statements of that fund, and more importantly, just that they've never issued what we call an opinion, which essentially is a bad point on the fund.
Okay. So these are obviously all the what one would call the external service providers to a hedge fund.
That's right.
In what way do you also check them? Because I'm guessing we see some cases where the administration is done by the fund manager, or for example, the auditor is not particularly well known. What do you do to try and get to the bottom of that and to try and get a good understanding of those situations?
You're absolutely right. What we do is that we actually have set forms that we send to all of these different counterparties, which have a number of questions, which even if they are in-house administrators or in-house custodians, as it can happen with very large institutions, by going through those same questions, we still get an analysis of their processes. And because most of them, in any case, are very large institutions with independent sections and independent businesses, we still go through the process of verifying and ensuring that all of the controls for any relationship that a hedge fund should have are in place, even if it's an in-house administrator or custodian.
Okay, so you basically check all these relationships and how they function, who's involved, and how they work, basically.
That is correct, exactly.
Okay. We just go back to the day-to-day business of the fund.
Right.
What do you do to sort of check the people? Obviously, you go and see them, but people have been known either sometimes to exaggerate the truth or bend the truth. what do you do in that case?
Well, so what we'll be, after the on-site visit, what we start to perform is the background checks.
Okay.
So we would analyze, we tend to do this both before and after. Reason for doing this is that if you perform some element of a background check ahead of a visit, it's a great way to then discuss it with the manager and really understand their side of the story. It could be something as simple as checking court documents and seeing that they've recently been involved in a lawsuit. That doesn't mean that automatically it is a major issue. It's just something that needs further digging into and further analysis.
You need an answer to that. So just because someone's involved in something that hit the headlines,
that's
doesn't
right.
necessarily mean it's a bad thing.
Yeah.
You need to get an understanding of it.
You're absolutely right.
You need to get an explanation about that.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. But then you still want to check. You want to check other elements of their background and what other people think of them. So, we would discuss with references. We would discuss with both personal references for the managers, mm-hmm. for the traders, and also we wanted to discuss with investor references. So how other investors who may have been invested in a fund for a number of years, what do they think about the fund? What do they think about the data that they receive from the fund? When did they get in? How did they invest and so forth?
Okay, so basically two sorts of things. You're sort of saying we talk to other people in the industry who just know these people.
Yes.
But you also talk to other investors who have invested with them. But I'm guessing that's not always a fail-safe solution either. But at least it gives you an idea of what's going on.
Exactly. Yeah. Okay. And then obviously we want to, you know, especially after the on-site visit, we want to go into quite a lot of detail about the manager's background. Right. And here's where we would look at regulatory websites. We would want to see where the managers came from, who did he work with previously, and we want to see, you know, again, if there is any issues both in the public or private domain that we should be aware of and that we should tell our clients about.
Okay, but surely then, you know, because in the environment of the investment world, every, you know, thinks that everybody knows each other and everybody just, you know, tells stories or lies on each other's behalf. How far do you really go back into checking someone's background? I mean, do you even check, you know, check university degrees?
Yeah, we do, actually.
Oh, really?
We go that far, yes. So we want to check university degrees, educational records. We want to check, you know, if they are, for example, a CFA or a CAIA, which is very often an industry education. You know, we want to check whether or not they're still members of that association and so forth.
Because that's also very useful piece of information. You know, you have these websites as well where you can go and check it, and if they're no longer part of that organization, they're not part of that website.
That is correct.
Okay.
Exactly. Yes.
Got it.
And you know, even here, I can quickly show you, you know, on one side we have a client reference questionnaire where we collect information about the investor reference, which I was recently referring to. But also on the other hand, we have access to the US courts. And again, these are databases that are open, some public, some private, but you can get quite a lot of information and you can really dig deep into the managers, into their backgrounds, into the names of the management companies, the names of the funds, and get quite a lot of data.
Okay, good. So you've gathered all this information.
That's right, yeah.
I'm guessing that you have stacks of paper on your desk. What do you do with all this information now?
Well, this is really where we then go into the final analysis and we compile it into one report.
Okay.
So different people take different steps, but this is the step that we have taken in order to remain completely objective in our views when we rate hedge fund managers and hedge fund structures. So, you know, the most simple way is to follow the standards and to simply say, does this manager meet the standard or not? And that can be a very subjective way of doing it. Mm-hmm. However, we've devised a qualitative matrix which still follows the standards, but follows them in a way that is completely objective by answering questions on liquidity, on the transparency that we've received, on investment restrictions, the investment risks, and so forth.
Okay, but you know, me as sort of outsourcing this work to you, how do I know that you're also actually doing this work?
That we're going through the steps of this work. Well, this is actually where our ISO comes really into play, because as part of an association that follows an ISO standard, we are audited every year to ensure that every time we undertake this level of analysis and that we don't take any shortcuts depending on, you know, the project that we're doing. So we follow the ISO process, we're audited every year, and we ensure that we always answer the question in the same way.
Okay. So you basically aggregate everything. You have a qualitative way of scoring things, and you can remain completely objective in doing this. And
that's
then sort of comes out with a final score.
Well, before that, actually, what we tend to add, as we said earlier, is an element of the investment due diligence, which is the quantitative side.
Okay.
So we want to make sure that, you know, if there is a fund that has the best standards and meets all of the requirements that, you know, we believe, again, they should meet, but if they're not performing, then it's unlikely that our clients are not going to want to invest in them. So we add an element of investment due diligence and quantitative scoring, and we look at peer comparisons, we look at the possibility of any style drift, the risk and statistical analysis of the fund, to ensure that, again, it meets the requirements of our clients within their specific mandates.
Okay.
And as a final step, this is really then where we score it. And we take 75% of the qualitative score, so those independent objective analysis that we perform, and then 25% of the quantitative score, so the returns, and this is how we achieve the final scores.
Okay, so obviously in this whole process you give far more weight to the qualitative scores, so how the fund is set up, the people behind it, the infrastructure behind it, and so on. And you give us, I suppose, a lower score then to the quantitative score in terms of how it's performed and so on.
That's right. I mean, at the end, we are supposed to be operational due diligence experts, and therefore we approach it from an operational due diligence point of view. However, as we said earlier, without investment due diligence on top of it, we think we'll be missing elements that are very important to the final decision.
Okay, good. Well, Max, I think I've got a pretty clear view now of what it is you're doing. So you've got a very clear process of how you go through the different steps. You trust, but verify what the work is that's been delivered to you. And you've got quite a clear process and lots of different steps you do go through. Just out of interest, when you do a normal due diligence on a fund, how long does it take you?
Well, the usual time is about 4 to 6 weeks. And it's about 100 hours of work from start to finish. Okay. But we split that internally between a number of individuals. So on a typical project, there are at least 5 people involved. And out of that, out of those 5 people, you also have somebody who has a legal background, and you also have somebody who has a compliance and rules background. So to ensure that, again, we are reviewing and properly assessing the entire operations of the fund, and we use individuals within our firm who are experts at this and also help on a day-to-day basis to set up hedge funds and to structure hedge funds. And therefore, we have a complete different approach from other firms who are doing operational due diligence because we're involved day-to-day in the hedge fund world.
Okay. So what you're saying is basically because of your experience and background in setting up hedge funds, you have a certain insight into that. I suppose your involvement also with regulatory authorities and also having your internal law firm gives you a certain amount of insight as to how things should be. You tie all this together, you have the experts looking at it, so it's not just, you know, Max or Jerome looking at a fund.
Exactly.
It's actually a whole team of people. It takes you quite a lot of time listening to you. And that's basically what you deliver then in a final report with a score.
Exactly.
Well, thanks very much for that, Max. I think I've got a pretty good understanding of a lot of the work you do.